Hello viewers, today we are going to introduce you to the concept of inverse of trigonometric functions. But before that, let's just revisit the concept of inverse of a function, which you learn in the chapter 1, relations and functions. What do you know about inverse of a function? The definition says that if f is a function from the set x to the set y, such that f of x is equal to y, and if it is 1, 1 and onto, then we can define a unique function g mapped from y to the set x such that g of y is equal to x, where x belongs to the set x and y belongs to the set y. G is called inverse of f and is denoted by f inverse, written like g to the power minus 1, but never to be read as g to the power minus 1, otherwise you may just start writing it as 1 by g, which is completely meaningless. So, we denote and read it as g inverse. Let us refresh the idea of inverse of a function with just one example here. We have a function f defined from real numbers to real numbers as f of x is equal to x plus 1. Can you find inverse of f? Before we start thinking about inverse of f, what are the two things that you need to look out for? Is f 1, 1 and onto? You must be an expert by now to decide on that. 1, 1, no two values of x should give rise to the same value of f of x. Onto, every real number must have a pre-image. I am sure you will be able to try that out very easily on your own. What would be the inverse in this case? This is just like a one mark question, so you should be able to think right on your feet there. Every x goes to x plus 1, so 5 gets mapped to 6. How do I get the inverse? 6 has to come back to 5, so I should have 1 less than x. So, we define the inverse of f such that every element gets mapped to 1 less than its value. And so, we have the function 1 f as a 1 1 and onto, and inverse of it defined as a function from real numbers to the real numbers defined such that f inverse of y is equal to y minus 1, where y belongs to real numbers. Now, y is used here only as a symbol. It is not necessary that you use y thinking that there is a set y on which the mapping has been done. Y can easily be replaced by an x. So, you can always say f inverse of x is equal to x minus 1, where x will belong to again real numbers, the domain of the function f inverse. That is more important than anything else. Now, what exactly does it mean by all this that we have done and learned in the earlier chapter? Does it have any significance? Could you visualize and see what the connection of a function with its inverse is? Every time I take 5, it gets mapped to 6 through f. Inverse brings 6 back to 5. Let's take a minute on the graphical interpretation of this exchange of position of the coordinates of a point. Here we have a point 1 comma 2, which lies on the graph of f. And 2 comma 1 lies on graph of f inverse. That means, for every a comma b that lies on the graph of f, b comma a lies on the graph of f inverse. Is there a pattern here? Is there significance here? Yes, there is. We say that this also means that f inverse is the reflection of f along the line y equal to x. The graph of f inverse, when reflected along the line of y equal to x, will give rise to the other function. Let's take a look at the graphical interpretation of f inverse with respect to the f as a reflection of the function along the line y equal to x. Let's begin with a line y equal to x, and let's plot our function, that is y equal to x plus 1. Being a linear function, it is a straight line. If I take a point P on this line, say in this case its coordinates are 2.5 and 3.5. If I reflect this point P along the line y equal to x, I get a point P dash with the coordinates 3.5, 2.5. What does it mean by reflection? You can even try this at home. If you crease the paper along the line y equal to x and make a pinprick at the point P, it will leave an impression that is where the point P dash would be. Do you see the interchange of the A and B, that is the x coordinate and the y coordinates of the point P and P dash here? Observe it further. If I drag this point P along the line y equal to x plus 1, P dash is also leaving a certain trace, a certain locus is being formed. What would you expect the equation of this locus to be? If you had kept an eye on the coordinates of the point P dash as P drags along the line, what do you see? Is there a relation? Yes, definitely. The relation is nothing but what you expect it to be, y is equal to x minus 1. And that is exactly what the inverse of the function fx equal to x plus 1 was. So, if I reflect the line y is equal to x plus 1 along the line y is equal to x, I get the inverse of that function. And that is exactly what the graphical significance of a function and its inverse is. We have to move on to the concept of inverse trigonometric functions, and we will see that this relation remains true even there. One of the very important results that came up again and again in the previous chapter was that a function f is invertible if and only if f is 1, 1 and onto. So, when we want to think about inverse trigonometric functions, the big question is a sine function invertible? That is sine function a 1, 1 and onto function? Let's spend a little time on understanding what the sine function is before we talk about inverse of sine. We have the graph of fx equal to sine x, a wavelength, smooth, continuous graph. Domain of sine function is entire real numbers, and the range, well, the graph is restricted between minus 1 and 1, therefore, the range is close interval minus 1 to 1. Now, we want to think about this function being a 1, 1 and onto. Do you think the function is 1, 1? The function becomes 1, 1 if for no two values of x, we get the same value of f of x. If you observe the graph closely, would you be able to comment and say whether the function is 1, 1 or not? Well, very obviously no, because there are so many values along the x-axis at which sine of x becomes 0, isn't it? So, the function is very clearly not a 1, 1 function. I can always make it onto by mapping it onto the range of f, which is a close interval minus 1, 1. Let's also look at what we call as a horizontal line test, which is a very useful test to decide whether the function is 1, 1 or not, provided you know what the graph looks like. Well, you definitely know what the graph of sine x look like. And if I take a horizontal line, which in this case is cutting the graph at more than one point, typically this means that the function is not 1, 1. Think about why. Why does this say that the function is not 1, 1? If a horizontal line cuts the graph at more than one point, it means that there are more than one values of x at which f of x is same, and therefore, the function is not 1, 1. So, sine function fails to be 1, 1 over its entire domain of the set real numbers. So, to think about the inverse of it, can I maybe limit the domain? Can we put some restrictions? Can we be selective on the domain of the function and then discuss its 1-1-ness? If you look at this graph closely, can you identify the sub-intervals of the real line over which the function is 1-1? That is, look for that piece of the function which is cut by the horizontal line only once and I want it to be on 2. So, I want all values from minus 1 to 1 covered in that. I am sure you are coming up with many answers. And yes, there is no unique answer to this. You can have several intervals over which the function is 1, 1 and on 2. As you can see in this graph with the different colors, you can see a minus 3 pi by 2 to pi minus pi by 2, minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2, 3 pi by 2 to 5 pi by 2. These are all sub intervals of the real numbers over which the function is not only 1, 1, it is on 2 as well. And that is where we are now ready to define inverse of the trigonometric function and especially of the sine. And so, now over these sub intervals, we are able to see the sine function to be 1, 1 and on 2. Sine defined from minus pi by 2, pi by 2 to the closed interval minus 1, 1 or pi by 2, 3 pi by 2 to minus 1, 1 or any other sub interval that you identified over which the function is 1, 1 and on 2 has an inverse defined. So, we define inverse of sine function as sine inverse mapped from closed interval minus 1, 1 to the closed interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 as sine inverse of x is y if y is equal to sine x. This branch is called the principal value branch. You can define sine inverse over other intervals as well, where the range could be any other sub interval that we just discussed. But if it is a principal value branch, the range of sine inverse must be minus pi by 2, pi by 2 as a closed interval. Let us take a look at the graph of sine inverse as reflection of sine along the line y equal to x. So, again we have the line y equal to x and the graph of y equal to sine x. If I take a point A on this graph and reflect it along the line y equal to x, if I drag the point A, it will leave a certain trace. Do you see that happening? And if I move it further up and down, you are able to see the same wave-like curve draped along the y-axis. So, there is kind of an interchange of x and y happening here. But what is the principal value branch? The principal value branch is only when we are defining it between the interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. And therefore, the sine inverse function is defined only when the sine function was 1, 1 on 2. And for that, we had to select sub intervals of the real lines over which the function is not only 1, 1, but on 2 as well, with the range minus 1, 1. And we define the sine inverse x to be y when x was sine of y. This is typically what we will be doing for other inverse trigonometric functions as well. Let us take a simple one mark question based on what you have learned today. Find the principal value of the following: sine inverse minus 1, sine inverse 1 by 2. Sine inverse minus 1 is our first part. Let us try that. Since it is our first question, you may just do it a little more detailed. Otherwise, it can be done orally as well. Suppose y is equal to sine inverse of minus 1, then by definition, sine of y is minus 1. Sine of y is minus 1 at infinitely many values of y. But since our principal values lie between minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, you will only select that y which gives us minus 1 and lies in this interval, which obviously is minus pi by 2. And that is the principal value of sine inverse minus 1. I am sure you will be able to try the second part also on your own. But here is the solution for you: sine inverse 1 by 2. If you write y to be sine inverse 1 by 2, then sine of y is 1 by 2 by the definition of the inverse. For principal values, again you will select the value which lies between minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 including the endpoints, which is nothing but pi by 6. And that is the answer for sine inverse of 1 by 2. So, with this we end today's lesson. Hopefully, you have understood not only what sine inverse is, but you also have been able to visualize the inverse of a function taken as a reflection along the line y equal to x. We'll discuss principal value branch of the other inverse trigonometric functions in our next lesson. Thank you.